Good morning. It's early, isn't it? We start this early, and we do apologize to you for starting this early, but in order to pack everything in, all the exciting things that are happening in this space, we need every minute we can get. So I've got several announcements to you. It's a little early for me, y'all. I've got several announcements to make. The first thing I would like to say is just a huge thank you to all of you for your patience with us yesterday. Because of the reorganization and remodeling of different spaces here at Fort Mason, we've had to rearrange how we're doing things and the configuration that we have in here in Festival Pavilion is the biggest example of that. And of course, we're not able to test what this would be like having 1,000 people in the building until yesterday. And the way we had it set up at first did not work very well. We've made several changes to the way the microphones are working and to the way the speakers are pointed. And we think that we are going to be able to handle the noise a lot better. But the big thing today is the Blue Angels will be flying. So if you think the noise problems we had yesterday were bad, it's going to get worse. So be ready for those sonic booms or whatever it is that's going to fly across. They're getting ready for an air show that is right here, and they practiced it right here. So just giving you a heads up, as it were. I also want to tell you about SOCAP TV. It is happening in Batts Theater. And what SOCAP TV is, it is a theater that is recording 12 to 15 minute talks for us to put up later. We have tried to figure out how to get people to watch 20 and 30 minute talks like we do here on the main stage, and they're really just not that interesting. They don't have that much of an afterlife on the internet, but in an effort to try to get the word out about what's happening with social enterprise and impact investing, we are doing these 12 to 15 minute videos asking people to bring their very best ideas to a very succinct talk. So that's happening in Batts Theater. It's in your program book on page 29. You can go and watch those. I know it's tempting to not go watch them because you will get to see them later, but it's also a great kind of place to go and wind down. It's not interactive. You go and listen to somebody do a talk. Anything from Lisa Kleisner talking about targeting systems level impact to Peggy Clark talking about artisan enterprise and the new startup economy and everything in between. You can find something you'd be interested in there. And again, that's on page 29 in your program book, what's happening at SOCAP TV. I also want to call your attention to the marketplace again. Our ladies from Thistle Farms are there with their goods, with their herbal healing oils. There's also jewelry that some of our entrepreneurs have made, various items that entrepreneurs around the globe are making that they have brought in. If several people have said they're doing their Christmas shopping there tomorrow, so you may want to go today before it's all bought. While Chuck Cannon won't be with us this morning, he will be back this afternoon, and he will be in the marketplace at noon with his CDs. Many of you have come to tell me how much you have enjoyed having him here, which was a great relief to me. It's a little weird, you know, and scary to bring a musician and put him on the stage at a conference like this. So anybody else who wants to tell me that it was a great idea, I'm glad to hear it. So thank you for affirming me in that. So it looks like our room is beginning to fill up, and we have another great packed session for you this morning, and Lindsay Smalling, who has put all this together, is going to come and tell you a little bit more about it. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Thursday. All right, so yesterday, hopefully you were all here for the plenary and enjoyed your sessions. What we were really trying to do yesterday is set the stage for the amazing history that this field has, the leaders, and the moment that we're in, this moment of transition where it really feels like we're hitting sort of an inflection point. And what I'm excited for you to see today is the way that there's a lot of new sectors, new industries coming in and re-understanding sort of their role. So what you're going to hear from the various segments in this morning's plenary are organizations that maybe seem like, of course, they're involved in impact investing, and others where you might not expect them to be involved in impact investing and social enterprise. But I think you'll really see how all these pieces fit together and make the industry a lot stronger. So who I'm going to bring up first, and I'm really excited for you to hear from, is Tyler Norris from Kaiser Permanente and Deb Nelson from Social Venture Network. And they're going to talk about the role of anchor institutions and the way that these anchor institutions are reimagining their role in society through employment, through procurement, and I'll let them tell you more.
Nancy. All right. Wow.
Yay.
Wow. Good morning, everyone. You all woke up early, and I have to say you all look so awake and focused. Either you're very excited to hear what Tyler has to say, or you've had a lot of caffeine already. So it's great to be here. My name is Deb Nelson. I'm the Executive Director of Social Venture Network, and I'm thrilled to be interviewing Tyler Norris, who's the Vice President of Total Health Partnerships at Kaiser Permanente. And for those of you who don't know Tyler already, he is an amazing human being, very innovative, very insightful, and most important, an incredibly kind person. He's been a social entrepreneur for the past 3 decades. He founded a dozen companies and social ventures. He started a program for homeless men back in his 20s that's still growing and thriving today. He created a national park system in Tajikistan in Central Asia. He has advised over 400 cities and government agencies and philanthropic institutions, and he's really a pioneer in the arenas of healthy communities and healthy people, and is just passionate about making sure that everyone has an opportunity to thrive and grow and be their best selves. So it's a pleasure to be here with you this morning.
Thank you, Deb.
And I wanted to start with the fact that you've done such innovative work in a different area of impact investing, in community health and community impact. And what inspired you to do the work that you do that focuses on healthy communities and healthy people? And what is the work that you're doing today that you're most excited about?
Thank you, Deb. Beautiful introduction. Good morning, everyone. My aspiration has always been to do what I could to contribute to healthier people and healthier communities. My daughter came home the other day and plopped an Institute of Medicine report on the table that said that after a century of increasing our lifespan by 30 years, that children born today will be the first generation that may live 5 years less than their parents. And she said, you've been on airplanes for the last 25 years. What have you been doing? And it's really this question of, what is it that actually produces health? If we spend $3 trillion a year on sick care services, why aren't we getting a return on investment to health rather than just more and more growth in the medical care sector? So I started working with Kaiser Permanente in my previous firm as a client and helped design their community health initiatives that have been flourishing across the country. But I decided to go inside, kind of pick my favorite client and go in for this reason. That I knew that Kaiser Permanente with the Affordable Care Act was going to bring in more people through Medicaid and the exchanges who were less healthy than the people that we have right now, and that we would be paid less, reimbursed less for those individuals at higher risk for health, and at the same time, how would we maintain the highest quality care in each of our markets? So high quality, more people, less healthy, less reimbursement, and that's what I said yes to. I was in for that challenge. And the reason is that that's what the country faces. We have to learn how to do that overall in the Affordable Care Act. And so Kaiser's model is a bit unique because we're both a delivery system with 20,000 physicians, a couple hundred thousand employees, and a health plan. We're actually at risk for the health of our members. In other words, we do better when people are healthy, as opposed to most hospitals get paid when people are sick. And so we actually have an incentive for healthier people and healthier places, and it causes us to sort of lean in more. So we're about a $60 billion company and a nonprofit. We were born in the Richmond shipyards, and Rosie came out of Kaiser Permanente's early work. And I think the key piece for us is not just us, but as we look at what the incentives are for the healthcare sector, 20 cents of every dollar in the country. The incentives increasingly in the Affordable Care Act is how do we produce value for those dollars, not just more volume of care. A lot of people make money off of sickness. Our goal is to actually, how do we do better by producing health in the first place? And how do we do that in a way that's more affordable? Because clearly, the costs of healthcare are on top of every product, every service, and it's a tax, essentially, on that, and it's challenging America's competitiveness, frankly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That makes total sense. Thank you. So I am a Kaiser Permanente member. I've been a member for 15 years, and I will always be grateful to Kaiser because their doctors and nurses saved my son's life nearly 8 years ago. So you have a strategy that's brilliant, and you can have, you know, any company or nonprofit can have a brilliant strategy, but if it's not working on the ground and if it's not working human to human, it doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
But I've been more and more impressed with your model, how innovative it is, how effective it is in terms of community impact, and one of the ways that you get at that is by investing $1.5 billion in firms that are owned by women and people of color. Yeah. Hats off to you for that.
Yeah, thank you.
I know that's a big part of your work. Can you talk a little bit more about that and how that ties into your model for community impact and health?
Sure. If we're going to talk about impact, and it looks like the slide's not loading very well, but we need to talk about what creates health in the first place. Only 10% of what creates health has to do with medical care services, and 30% is genetic and our biological inheritance. It means that 60% of what creates health has to do with behaviors in the context of the socioeconomic environment in our communities. In other words, health care is an intervention. It does not create health. Healthy communities and economic opportunity, education, access to food, access to mobility, access to a living wage job, that's what actually contributes to health. So if we're at risk for population health, and frankly, we think that the healthcare sector ought to be at risk for producing health, not just more services, we need to invest in what creates health in the first place, and it has to do with a much broader array of issues. So what we've learned in our significant investments, about $2 billion a year worth of community benefit, is that doing 2 and 3 and 4 5-year grants and 10,000 here and 100,000 here and a million there, it does not create a healthy community. You find bright spots, we do interesting things, but it doesn't scale unless we go all in with everything we have. So our model has been moving from not only how do we just do good grant making and all that, but how do we use literally every asset of our organization to improve health? So back to the whole idea of procurement, right? We do $1.5 billion with women and minority-owned firms. That's out of $15 billion of total procurement. And what we're saying is we not only want to get the best deal to manage costs, but how can we use that purchasing to drive the local economy so that by spending money with local companies who invest that money locally rather than it being exported to Wall Street actually drives the flywheel of the local economy, which is a health-producing factor. So that's one part of it with our procurement. With our HR, for example, we're expanding right now in Baltimore. We're moving into Freddie Gray's neighborhood. We can't just come in there and put in a medical facility and put some grants. We need to grow the workforce. And the people who we need to hire, some of the skills are missing in that community. So we're partnering with the high schools and the community colleges and the workforce investment boards to grow the workforce skills, which again, not only helps meet the care needs, but particularly to grow the determinants of health through building local wealth creation. And then increasingly, we're using our investment portfolio, my colleague Liz Rocket is here from KP Ventures, to be able to make investments. So for example, if we're trying to scale access to healthy food, we can make grants, we can do multi-year contracts with smaller companies that it's bankable to buy a truck, a refrigerator, or pasteurizing, and we can make capital available to actually scale food. And we can do that with mobility, home care, and other areas. So we're saying, in order for us to have the impact we want, we need to be all in with everything we have, And we need to have partnership, because clearly, and as you look out at this room and who's at SOCAP, so much of the skill sets and technologies and approaches and relationships that are needed to deliver on this, we don't have. We may be big, we may be able to do a lot with this kind of resource, but we have to partner with, frankly, everybody in this room to be able to deliver on that equation, not only with our friendly competitors, who we work with very closely. We can compete on cost and quality, but when it comes to health, we need to be all in with our competitors and with our with the diversity of the innovators in a community to actually produce that kind of an outcome. Mm-hmm. So investing and buying local is it, and we have to do much more.
Mm-hmm. That makes a lot of sense. So how do you measure your impact, and what's the impact that you've measured that you're most proud of?
So we measure everything, and you know, I don't have my smartphone here with me, but we have 10 million members, and everybody can get their electronic medical record on their phone, email their doctor, see their lab, see their test. It's coordinated, so we actually have a tremendous amount of data that we're able to use to improve the quality of care and manage costs, which is what makes us a great health plan and a great system. But we also measure underneath clinical quality and cost, we're also measuring the determinants of health. We do community health needs assessments every 3 years, and in fact, it's a very much of an ongoing quality process, so we can correlate cost and quality with the outcomes of population health. How are we reducing diabetes rates? Do people have access to fresh food? What are education rates in the community? What is the rate of people living with living wage? What are education attainments? In Oakland, where my new adopted community, the high school graduation rate for young black men is in the 30% range. That's not okay. We're focused on that with everything we have in Oakland Unified Schools because we know that's upstream. So we measure what traditionally hospitals measure, but we're also measuring all the determinants of health. And then with Health with PwC right now, we're actually looking at how we measure all of our impacts, the social impacts, the environmental, economic, and economic impacts, so that we have a baseline on intended and unintended, beneficial and not beneficial, what are we really doing, so that we have a very deliberate way to make sure that everything we do is adding up socially, economically, environmentally, as well as then producing health as a byproduct of that, rather than thinking about health as an intervention of a medical care system. So if you go back to our business model, the reason that it's important that we measure all that is that for us to deliver the best care at the best cost, we need to be able to invest in communities in a way that certainly provides care for people who need it, like we were talking about with your family earlier, but that reduces the preventable demand, that reduces the demand on the system, which is actually preventable, that's driven by inadequate investments in communities of color, the lack of health equity, disparities, and our communities struggling economically through disinvestment and the kind of things that Gar and Angela and all were talking about yesterday. That's why we're all in for that. Things we're proud of, for example, are we just invested $1 billion to meet 50% of our total energy use through wind and solar. That's creating green jobs here in Alameda County through the wind farms, and down in Riverside County through the solar there. That is a 20-year investment that's helping build the market for wind and solar for large folks. So that's the kind of thing we're measuring and tracking about what we want to hold ourselves accountable to. Since we're not accountable to Wall Street, we're accountable to our members and Main Street.
Mm-hmm. That's great. More power to you.
Yeah.
So both the mission of Kaiser Permanente and the work that you do, it really supports the notion that healthcare is a human right and not a privilege for those who can afford it. Can you talk a little bit about healthcare and equity?
My vision of the American dream does not include rationing healthcare by wealth. So I think morally, we have a responsibility to everyone in this country to make sure they get care for themselves and their families and their children at the right place, at the right time, et cetera. That's a moral value of ours, and it matches what Henry Kaiser thought when he founded the company and gave the health plan away to become a nonprofit rather than make it a for-profit. But there's an economic case, too. It just does not make sense to not provide preventive care, to not invest in what creates for the health in the first place, to have people miss work, have their families struggle, you know, all the things that we go through when we're sick, ourselves are going through, and then have people end up in the emergency department at five times the cost and pay for that? Why don't we invest in creating healthy food and access to physical activity and supports in the first place rather than just reimbursing for more diabetes care? And I think that's really what we're saying is there's a lot of money to be made in sick care, and we're trying to make sure we're making it out of what's creating health in the first place, since that's really the mission.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Beautiful.
And that's where equity makes it really mm-hmm. important. And I don't mean cash equity. I'm talking about equity of opportunity mm-hmm. for everybody in our country. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'd love to hear a little bit more about what call to action you have for this community, yeah. the SOCAP community, the mission-driven business community, the impact investing community. I invite you to challenge us a little bit and share what we can do together.
I've been at this work of trying to create healthy communities for a long time, and I'm humbled by it. It is not easy. It takes a tremendous amount of time. It takes the kind of time and patience that it does to raise a family. And I think we need to be thinking generationally about this, not how do we make, you know, a quick product or app and flip it out in the next year. Of course, our companies need to grow, but how do we make these longer-term investments in what creates health in the first place? So there's a lot that we can do, but really I want to make an invitation to folks in the room, and Liz and I here from Kaiser Permanente and our team basically want to make an invitation, because we know that if we want to look at the totality of what creates health and kind of address that we need to scale access to healthy, fresh food so everybody has access to healthy, fresh, affordable foods, if we want to make sure that people live in safe neighborhoods where there is mobility, that there are transportation and transit systems that are available, that every young person has the opportunity to reach her or his potential, that we actually look at potentiation for everybody. We need to partner with our community organizations to help make that happen. And that those social, environmental, and behavior needs around home care and meeting people's, I mean, we can provide the best care in the world, which I think we do, but if we then put somebody back out into a toxic community, what the heck? That's not quality. That may be clinical quality. It's not total quality. So to be successful, we need your partnership. And that doesn't mean your pitch to our venture group or, hey, we ought to give a grant for this or that. That means we need to understand what can urban strategies bring and how do we work with you? How can we work with impact investors like Kresge and others that we're working with, Impact Capital, like we are in the California Fresh Works Fund, to actually bring capital to bear on those things that address the underlying needs that drive health and that meet the social and non-medical needs of patients. So what I'm saying, I think, is that as I look out at this room, I mean, look around, just yourself for a minute, look around. I mean, really, this is some of the most extraordinarily open hearts, bright people whose missions are to do something really good. Of course, many of you are building ventures, you're raising money, trying to bring home the bacon. Good for you. Go after it. But let's go back to what Gar said and the panel said yesterday. It's not about projectism. And let's not ever let this be some flea market of one company that's cooler than the next. We have an opportunity right now to take a look at what really is underneath prosperity, not only in this country, but in all the countries that we represent. This is a global opportunity. And so basically, I'm issuing an invitation. Come meet with us and talk with us about here's what you're trying to scale. Here's what you're learning. Not like some pitch, but here's what we might do together. And I think in the context of SOCAP, Social Venture Network, Bali, the Democracy Collaborative, and the local partnerships on the ground, not to mention the investors and innovators and grassroots leaders on the ground that are really touching what matters most, we can actually have an impact that creates the dream that I believe we're capable of in this country and around the world, and that this group is capable of doing it. So join with us, and let's do something that is worthy of our lives.
Mm. That's a beautiful invitation. Thank you, Tyler. All right. I just want to thank you, Tyler, and I invite you all to take him up on his invitation. Please come
There's
see
Liz.
Him. And Liz Rocket, come see me after the session. We're going to be joining you in a minute. and share your ideas on how we can connect the dots, how we can all expand our impact together. Thank you all for being here.
Great.
Thank you, Tyler.
Thank you, Deb.
So Tyler just told you how they're really taking an expansive view of their whole portfolio at Kaiser. And I think as all of you think about your whole portfolio, there's a pretty good chance that includes some holdings in public markets. The ESG and SRI community has been around for many, many decades and precedes the impact investing industry. And I'm really excited to have Steve Falsey here from Pax World Investments to tell you a little bit about the way that they're thinking about the expanding and important role of ESG and SRI in impact. Steve.
Thank you, Lindsay, and good morning. I first came to SOCAP 3 years ago, intrigued by all the energy around impact investing, and wanted to see how sustainable public market investments fit in and become a part of that conversation. It's been great to see how SOCAP has helped that conversation evolve, and I'd like to continue it here this morning at the plenary, and also where there's a panel at 11 that's going to deal a little bit more about how public markets integrate into impact investor portfolios. I have the privilege this morning of representing Pax World Investments, who's been a leader in sustainable investing dating back to 1971 when we launched the first socially responsible mutual fund. I'd like to share a little bit of our perspectives on the evolution of sustainable investing and the increased linkage across its evolution to impact, and how we very much believe that public and private market investments can be integrated in a holistic, impactful way. Our CEO, Joe Keefe, has suggested 3 stages to the evolution of sustainable investing. The first stage was socially responsible investing, where the focus was on exclusion of companies, usually based on specific issues. But there was also the early stages of share owner engagement, an ability to have impact by talking to companies and helping them change behaviors. And I don't think anyone would deny one of the biggest and most impactful events that sustainable investing has had is the engagement and the subsequent divestment of companies doing business in South Africa that led and was a contributor to bringing down apartheid in that country. This first stage continued where we would see it into the first decade of the 21st century, where we began to evolve into sustainable investing, where the emphasis was no longer on exclusion, but on inclusion, including companies in a portfolio based on their environmental, social, and governance profiles, looking at the risks and the opportunities in these variables and integrating it with traditional financial analysis to make better investment decisions. At this stage, there was a lot of support from studies and research that showed, in fact, ESG factors could have financial materiality. Institutional investors began to take notice and began to embrace sustainable investing as an investment decision, investment discipline, rather than just a values choice. And traditional money managers have begun to take notice. Nevertheless, today we see sustainable investors want more. Okay, my portfolio is invested in companies with good ESG profiles, but how can I make sure I'm invested in companies that are making a positive impact? We're moving here beyond the exclusion of SRI and beyond the mere integration of ESG in sustainable investing to look at demonstrable impact. And that takes us to the phase that we're in now, the impact phase, that many in this room have been leaders in bringing to the fore. It clearly builds on the first 2 phases, but brings additional clarity around 2 objectives, delivering competitive returns while also having significant social and environmental impacts. In many ways, I see impact investing as bringing clarity among a lot of the acronyms and abbreviations that sustainable investing has used and has caused, frankly, some confusion. It's brought impact, the term, and the objective to the fore through its role in looking at innovative vehicles to channel capital with precision to entrepreneurs and projects that might otherwise have fallen through the cracks. In doing so, they've delivered returns and had significant and measurable impact. And in doing this, I think they've put forth with clarity the aspirational goal for all of us, having impact at scale. But to do that, I believe we must continue to all come together, no matter how we choose our affiliations, whether we call ourselves socially responsible investors, sustainable investors, impact investors, or mainstream investors. We need to look at portfolios comprehensively for return and impact across asset classes and investment styles, looking at private market investments that are providing essential capital with focused impact, looking at sustainably publicly traded investments for companies with better ESG profiles and some of these companies that are providing impact at scale, and engaging with other companies to have an impact and make them better corporate citizens. And as we succeed in delivering returns with impact, we will all achieve what I believe is a uniting and overarching goal, is attracting more and more capital to building a just and sustainable world. Thank you.
More and more capital for a just and sustainable world sounds like a good idea. So this panel I'm very excited for. There were two huge announcements in the impact investing world this year from Bain Capital and from BlackRock. These major financial institutions are making big commitments to impact investing, but I think that's raised a lot of confusion from folks in the field trying to understand what that means and what we can expect, what the timelines are. We thought you might want to hear from them directly. So we've got Brian Trelstad from Bridges Ventures interviewing Deval Patrick of Bain Capital and Deborah Winchell from BlackRock. Please welcome them.
Good morning. I'm Brian Trelstad, a partner at Bridges Ventures, and it's a delight to be here to talk about impact investing going mainstream. When I was at Acumen Fund in 2009, we were thrilled at the prospect of raising $100 million to invest in emerging markets businesses serving the base of the pyramid. We thought that was real scale. Today, I'm proud to be part of a fund manager, Bridges Ventures, which manages roughly $1 billion investing funds in real estate, growth equity, and social sector, entirely dedicated to impact and sustainable investment. But sitting on stage next to a $75 billion asset manager, Bain Capital, and a $4.7 trillion, that is, trillion with a T, asset manager in BlackRock, it puts scale in perspective. So no two better people to talk about impact investing going mainstream than Governor Deval Patrick at Bain Capital and Deborah Winchell from BlackRock. So welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me start with you, Governor Patrick. You had a distinguished career in public service. You were the governor of Massachusetts. You were a senior executive in corporate America. After leaving the State House in January of this year, you could have done anything. Why did you choose impact investing?
Well, first of all, can I just make clear, I am not responsible for all $75 billion at Bain Capital. We're just standing up a new fund. But I would say sort of philosophically that I feel fortunate to have, like most people, want in search of meaning in their lives, to understand that for me to have meaning in my life, I had to have meaning in my work. And the jobs I have had in the main have been very meaningful, and I wanted that to continue. Your colleague and my mentor, Ronald Cohen, introduced me to this field, starting with social impact bonds when I was in office, and migrating, if you will, to impact investing was natural. Very serendipitous that the platform happens to be Bain Capital, and huge fun and opportunity in that, but that's a longer story.
And Deborah, how about you? You started your career in investment banking. You were the CFO of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. You were then the president of the Robin Hood Foundation. How did you come to BlackRock and impact investing?
Well, I would say with a lot of luck. I really can't believe that I'm having the opportunity to bring all this together at BlackRock. I went to business school already with an eye on how do you bring together discipline and analytics to social impact. And being a classic humanities major in college, I knew nothing about business or analytics. So after business school, I went into finance really with the intention of how do you learn to think about businesses in a more disciplined and sort of outcome-oriented way, and then never left or didn't leave for a very long time. And then at the Met, it was a great opportunity to help a mission-driven organization align its mission with financial outcomes. And as everybody in this room knows, even if you're mission-driven, you have to have a model that's sustainable. Going to Robin Hood was an incredible education around metrics. And how do you use metrics to measure things that are very difficult to measure, like poverty fighting? And I think it's with that lens and that background that I have the opportunity to come to a BlackRock and look at what is very traditional investment management and think about how can you balance two objectives at the same time.
Now, BlackRock is about as mainstream as it gets, with roughly 6% of the world's professionally managed capital. And yet it's still a relatively entrepreneurial firm. Can you tell us the story of how impact investing within BlackRock got launched and what your focus is right now?
Yeah, I love how it got launched, and it was one of the reasons that I was drawn so much to BlackRock. We had the whole area of engagement and responsible investing is very deep in BlackRock's DNA. It's been one of the largest sort of engagement firms in many years. It has a group that's been of 20 people who just spend time looking at ESG factors and thinking about how to vote our proxies. But in addition to that, there was a group of millennials at BlackRock who had been on their own researching impact investing, understanding the field, put together a business plan, went to our leadership and presented it, and got the sponsorship of our senior leaders to think about this in a more organized sort of business platform way. And that's when I came in. So really building on the back of an initiative that was very grassroots, even at BlackRock.
Mm-hmm. Great. And today, high level, some of the thoughts about where you're heading?
Sure. We look at this business, we look at this sector very broadly. We have tremendous respect and admiration for so many firms. I know, you know, we were just talking about who've been doing this for a long time. Mm-hmm. You know, we come at it in a different way. We you know, it's a very large ecosystem, and we think there's an opportunity to look across all asset classes, the public markets, the private markets, and really bring some definition, transparency, some measurement to a lot of areas of asset classes that don't really have anything in this area. And so, you know, using very clear definitions, helping clients, both institutional and retail, think about the motivations. What is it they'd like to achieve? And what are some potential solutions? Some of which I hope BlackRock offers, and I think many of which many people in this firm, in this room, will be offering as well. Mm-hmm. So I think that's how we feel this whole area can be more mainstream, by getting clients and investors comfortable. How do you define this world? What are the different segments? What's available in the public markets that's liquid? What great opportunities might be more accessible now in the private markets? So that's the approach we're mm-hmm. taking.
Great. And Governor, when you first started having conversations with the partners at Bain, what motivated them to think about raising an impact investment fund?
Existing limiteds had been asking. Okay. You know, I had friends at Bain Capital, and I was just in sort of soundboarding with them ideas that I had, frankly, in very different spaces. And one of the senior partners leaned forward and said, actually, we've been trying to figure out how to get into impact investing for a few years now. And they were having a conversation at the time about acquiring an impact fund of funds from a bank that was having, for a variety of reasons, to divest itself. They asked if I was interested in coming in and helping with that, and I said, actually, no, because I'm interested in direct investing. And one thing led to another, and they said, okay, let's do direct investing, come in and help us build the business. And we've resolved now to essentially do a private equity fund that would do investments, growth capital, and control investments in lower middle market firms in North America, operating in three areas, in sustainability, in health and wellness, and in something we're calling neighborhood revitalization. And we'll look forward to rolling that out formally, probably first quarter next year. We're busy putting the team together now.
Great. Yeah. What were some of the biggest arguments against the idea, or internal debate about either the strategy or whether this was a good idea?
Can you share some? I don't think there were any arguments against. I think we found ourselves very aligned on a couple of things, and I realize there's a range of view in this room, that first of all, that a competitive market-based private equity style return was important to deliver. And while I respect that there are folks along the spectrum there at Bain Capital, and personally, I think that's important for a whole host of reasons. We were focused very much on deal flow. Where were the real opportunities to come to scale? Because part of mainstreaming, I think, from our perspective, is how do you help a mission-driven enterprise, which is also a for-profit enterprise, demonstrate that it can operate at scale, and with all of the considerations that entrepreneurs always have about exits and liquidity, and for themselves and their investors, but also how you have mission lock, mm-hmm. And can you find someone in a secondary market, which I think, frankly, does not exist in this space today, who is going to be as respectful of the mission as of the financials. So I think we're actually quite aligned, and we've worked in an iterative process to what the size of the first fund should be and what the speed with which we should be trying thoughtfully to deploy those assets and what the timing of the second and third funds might be.
And Deborah, so much of impact investing is private capital, venture capital, private equity, and yet BlackRock is a leader in public equity fixed income. I'm just curious how you're thinking, you've talked a little bit about this, but how you're deploying these capabilities and how you see impact investing moving to the mainstream from institutional investors only towards individual, the retail investor.
Right. I think one of the ways that we're hoping we can help sort of broaden the market for these kinds of investments is just clarity about what it is we're offering. So first of all, we're looking across all asset classes, and we're looking at them in three ways. We're called BlackRock Impact, but it's really about sustainable investing. And we have a long history of business in screens, just excluding companies or industries because of values or missions of clients. We have a pretty deep existing practice around ESG, and we think there are a lot of opportunities to help clients marry ESG considerations, how companies operate, with financial return. And then that last category of impact, where we very much view it as, here's your financial outcome, here's your impact outcome, measurement, reporting, transparency, and taking that model and bringing that across asset classes. So for example, we're about to launch a product, or maybe we did just launch it this week, it's been a blurry week, that's a public equity product, but that incorporates impact reporting. So, to us, having that kind of product that can be scalable, liquid, mainstream, very clear impact reporting so that not just institutional, but retail clients can really understand what it is they're getting. We think taking that lens of reporting, whether it's in green bonds or infrastructure, some private, a lot of public, is just something that we can bring to the sector that hopefully will continue to create. We think there's a lot of interest in both the retail and the institutional markets, but increasingly provide a framework that makes clients and investors more comfortable taking these opportunities to their investment committees or just talking about them among themselves in a way that they can start to think about in a mainstream way. And when we say mainstream, it's having holdings that can be in your core portfolio. It's not that sort of 2-3% of your portfolio that maybe you're allocating to niche investments. We think that what's going to help move these conversations is allowing investors to talk about it in their mainstream holdings. That's going to start to change, I think, what we're all going to be able to start to encounter in that conversation with investors.
Well, and building on that and asking both of you, some would argue, and this is San Francisco after all, that this is not impact investing going mainstream, that this is impact investing selling out. So how do you defend against that potential critique and specifically define impact as central to your strategy? How do you keep the bar high, either of you?
Well, I'd start first, but given my last job, I'm accustomed to being criticized no matter what I do. if I walked on water, I used to say somebody would say, Patrick can't swim. So there are lots of different ways to be engaged in impact investing. I want to make clear that from our perspective, the impact is not secondary. We screen for impact theoretically first, and then the financials. And when I talk about scale, I'm not just talking about scaling the financials, I'm talking about scaling the impact. What is it we do from this baseline to get us there? and Bain Capital's custom has been to be a very activist investor, very engaged in helping to build the company, and our anticipation is we'd be engaged on both of those fronts, or all of those fronts going forward. Second thing I'd say is that, you know, in a way, you could see, I do see impact investing as the natural extension of, or maybe the articulation of a return to long-term value. We have a very short-term focused economy in the United States and in many parts of the world where we're managing quarter to quarter. And sometimes getting those short-term returns, I think, without regard to the long-term impact on the enterprise. Frankly, I think that has infected our politics as well, where we govern very much, you know, election cycle to election cycle or news cycle to news cycle and not generation to generation. If you think about the long-term value of an enterprise, that depends on more than one bottom line. Yes, the financial bottom line, but also environmental stewardship, the relationship with the community, the relationship with employees, and a whole host of things that we think of sometimes, I think, mistakenly in our short-term economy as secondary to the money. You know, we want to be very much about long-term value, and I think in that respect, the impact investing field and the patient capital or long-term value traditional investors are already aligned. They may not know it.
Yeah, I'd like to echo what Deval just said because, you know, BlackRock has always been very much about the long-term investing. We have a CEO, Larry Fink, who I think is known globally for really reinforcing that long-term approach to investing. And hand in hand with that is BlackRock's history of speaking to companies about their ESG behavior. You know, what are they doing on the environment, social, governance? Because we have to vote all these shares, we need to make sure that they're behaving in a responsible way. So we do think that having this model, very much like Bain, of what is the financial impact? Let's be very clear about what that return is. And what is the non-financial or, you know, sort of the other impact that every investment in every company and every project is creating, good or bad? Yeah. In terms of your question about is this impact light or, you know, what is it greenwashing, I think what we can do is, as I was saying before, be very clear about, with every product and every opportunity, what we're offering. If it's a screen, all we're doing is removing objectionable companies or industries that a client doesn't want in their portfolio. We're not calling that impact, but we do think there's an element of responsible investing from a client's perspective. That's a solution we can offer. When we're talking about ESG products, where we're looking at how a company behaves, we think that is also an element of responsible investing. We're not calling that impact, even though our name, I know, is BlackRock Impact. But, you know, we're going to be very clear with clients, this is what you're achieving, this is what you're accomplishing. And when we're talking about impact, we're talking about it in a way that I think is much more consistent with the way that it's been defined. But quite honestly, you know, to create something that gives broad access to lots of investors globally, and there is global demand for this, it's going to look different. And as long as we can be clear about what it is we're putting on the table, knowing that it might have some characteristics that are similar to traditional impact, but also differences, I think that's our obligation, you know, not to just put this all under this rubric or umbrella of impact, but be very clear what the trade-offs are and what it is we can deliver at scale. And when, you know, as Deval said, I don't manage or have anything to do with most of those trillions, but what BlackRock must do whenever it offers something, it needs to be scalable, and we need to be realistic about, you know, what we can offer. But I do think that having this opportunity to direct such significant capital to opportunities where these issues are being articulated and, you know, responsible investing and outcome-oriented conversations are happening is just a trend that's good for everyone.
Yeah. And do either of you guys have a house view on some of the industry standards, like the Sustainable Accounting Standards Board or GEARS? Are those things that are part of what you're thinking about putting together?
Yeah. We love it all. You know, we at BlackRock, we're working on our own standards, and at the same time, we're looking at industry standards. Mm-hmm. And if there's an industry standard that can be as rigorous as we think is needed, we'll jump over to the industry standard. You know, from our point of view, the most valuable thing we can do is help create broad standards. What is green? You know, what is, you know, when you talk about carbon intensity, what are we talking about? What is the measurement? Scope 1, scope 2, scope 3. You know, mm-hmm. just always pushing back. I think the SASB is fantastic work. Anything that drives clear reporting and measurement is good for everyone. Yeah. So we're, you know, I think I don't want to lump it all together, right. but we think every initiative that the industry is undertaking to try to drive to that kind of clarity is fantastic.
Brian, our intention is to measure at the enterprise level, at the level of our buckets, if you will, and also at the fund level. And we've gotten two kinds of feedback in talking to many of you in this room and in the field. One is, please, please, please use a measure that's already in common use rather than inventing one of your own, so that there is some ability. Thank you to the six of you I spoke to about that. There's some, so that there is some ability to compare with others who are doing comparable kinds of things on the private side. And the second is to, what is the second? I forgot the second. I'm having a, I'm having
so
a recovery moment. What?
The first one is so good.
So good. It so good. Trump's the second.
Yeah, it does trump the second. No, but the second is about not turning the enterprises in which we invest into data collection enterprises. Let them have their business and run their business. So let's get the data we can, and that is meaningful, and that actually gives us insights into the movement on the impact side, without being so burdensome about the detail that it becomes a distraction.
So go ahead.
No, no. So I was going to say, I think we are trending toward GEARS, IRIS as measures. Very excited about SASB. There's a gap kind of thing coming in this field. Sounds like BlackRock and others are going to have a lot to do with helping to shape that, and that'll be good.
Yeah, I think that you know, you hope it's coming together. You know, we look at something like green bonds, where there are a lot of conversations, and we're just pushing for the largest issuers to get around something that we can all adopt. When we look at infrastructure and we want metrics there, we're like, let's try to use whatever we can create in the green bond sector and use that in infrastructure. So I think that there's the more commonality even across asset classes, and the greater the simplicity, which I think is something you were also driving at with the data, you want it to be meaningful, but you don't want it to be so complex that no one can understand it or use it. Right. So we think it's that intersection that, you know, is really what we're driving toward.
Right. And finally, Deval, let me close with you. You have a pretty long perspective of not only how markets evolve in this country, but also of how movements can catalyze and have catalyzed change in this country. Is impact investing a market or a movement? And where do you see this market/movement heading over the next decade?
Well, I think it's both, and I think that's not unusual in markets. You know, the most interesting thing is talking to endowment CIOs about their hesitation around impact investing I asked them, were you around when this new idea called private equity was invented? And they said, yeah, we were around and we did that, and somehow or other they figured out that could work. I think conscious capitalism is a powerful idea. And I think the notion that, and an important and timely idea. And I think it will grow. And it will be up to those of us in this room and rooms like it to spread the word and not feel quite so jealous, and I say that lovingly, but quite so jealous about how great we feel about what we're doing in this room. We have to proselytize a little bit mm-hmm. about the importance of aligning our values with financial value. If the planet is to be saved, if communities are to be uplifted, and frankly, if capitalism itself is to survive. So my view is back to what I was saying earlier. We've got to move to a more long-term way of thinking about economic value. And when you think about it that way, social and environmental value are very much aligned.
Great. Well, that's very well said, and hopefully the large crowd here understands that these conversations are now happening within mainstream institutions. And so the conversation that we've been part of over the last decade is, in fact, now around the partnership table at Bain and in the senior leadership at BlackRock. So I want to thank you both for taking the time and welcome you to the impact investing industry. And we'll look forward to seeing you around at many SOCAPs to come.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian.
Thanks.
Appreciate it. Good to be with you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank
this
you.
Is good. I know.
Now for a brief commercial interruption, some announcements. I made this announcement earlier, but wanted, with more people in the room, to say a deep thank you to all of you for your patience with us yesterday as we worked on our sound issues. And we have made some adjustments in this hall that we believe are going to make it better. It's not going to be perfect. There is going to be bleed through from the rooms, but we hope that you'll bear with us because working in this kind of space and not a hotel environment, there's a limited amount of things we can do. And it's going to get worse. You all know the Blue Angels are flying this weekend, and they start rehearsing this afternoon. And we ask you, yes, there are going to be sound interruptions. So when they fly over, if you're talking, just as I said yesterday, take a deep breath, do some yogic breathing, that will pass. Also, I want to call to your attention SOCAP TV, which is happening in Batts Theater. It's a great place to go. It's not interactive. People are there giving 12 to 15 minute talks that we are recording to show on our site later. There's some great talks happening there. Be sure and check it out. I think it's on page 27 in your program book. Everything that's happening there, if you want to just take a break from the fire hose that's coming at you in these rooms here, SOCAP TV is a great place to do that. And finally, I want to commend the marketplace to you, where I hear there is some great Christmas shopping going on with the products from Thistle Farms and from entrepreneurs around the world. And at noon today, Chuck Cannon will be there signing CDs. If you're interested in taking a little bit of Chuck's music home with you, you can do that today at noon, and Chuck will be back with us in our session tonight. And now I'm going to turn it back over to Lindsay.
Hi, everyone. SOCAP is a great place with all these folks in the room to make some exciting new announcements. And Calvert Foundation, which has been a longtime partner of SOCAP and is always coming out with new ways to democratize impact and reach new populations, is here with an announcement. Jennifer Price.
Thank you, Lindsay, and thank you, SOCAP, for taking this time to be with you to make this short announcement, but really very deeply connected to what we're witnessing at Calvert Foundation as this field moves into the mainstream. I share this vision or this view from where I'm witnessing it at Calvert Foundation. We are an impact investing fund. We've raised over $1 billion. But we've done it in a very special way. What we have done is enable U.S. retail investors to engage in this movement. So that means everyday people like you and I being able to invest for as low as $20. We also have investors as large as $20 million. And all that capital we aggregate and then invest in social entrepreneurs around the world. So connected to yogic breathing, I was going to take you on just a short journey this morning. To kind of drive home the reason why we're creating this new product in the market. So if you could close your eyes, don't fall asleep, just kind of ground your feet on the floor, and you might start to understand that I opened a yoga studio before I came into this world as leading Calvert Foundation. So this is enjoyable for me. But close your eyes, ground your feet, take a big breath in, and take a big breath out. And as you breathe out, kind of clear all the clutter out of your mind so you can have some clean space. And in that clean space, I ask you to develop an image of an impact investor. Envision this person's face, their eyes, their hair, their mouth. Get a clear vision of this person and hold this vision. Hold this vision. And then, as you open your eyes, I ask you, does your vision look like any of the people here on this screen? This is the opportunity. This is our future. Latinos, women, millennials will be transforming our investment landscape. These are groups that perhaps have not been activated now, even into the traditional investing market, simply because there's not the on-ramps, so people don't feel empowered. Perhaps they're not aware because it's not culturally resonant how we're communicating. Things as simple as language, English, Spanish. Or because perhaps they don't have the assets yet, the wealth, to really invest and be part of a movement. But this is the future investments, and the future of the social capital markets. We need them involved in the work that we are doing. We at Calvert Foundation have spent the last few years engaging these groups of people, women, individuals, millennials. And at SOCAP 15, we're proud to announce a new initiative, Raíces, which means roots in Spanish, in English. And roots symbolizes what we've learned from our market research, that Latinos both see their roots here in the U.S. and in their countries of heritage. This initiative will invest 25 million predominantly Hispanic regions in the U.S. and Latin America, targeting education, healthcare, and financial services. Latinos are a powerful economic, social, and cultural force, one that is poised to expand dramatically over the next 40 years. If impact investing is going to become mainstream practice, that means Latinos need to be involved. So come visit us at our booth. Go visit vested.org. And just a quick moment as I wrap up to acknowledge the people that made this partnership, this initiative possible. IDB, MacArthur and Kellogg Foundation, as well as the State Department at USAID. So this is your opportunity to broaden the impact investing movement. Go make an investment and join us. Thank you.
All right. So hopefully you've enjoyed the session so far. That big panel with Bain and BlackRock is going to be followed now by some folks that you expect to see at SOCAP. You maybe expect to see a lot of places where you're looking at social change. Ford Foundation, MacArthur Foundation, and the Gates Foundation have all been doing amazing work for years, and they've all redoubled their efforts around impact investing and understanding the power of using these markets for change. They're also re-understanding their role, and they're here to tell you a little bit more about that. So I'm welcoming Greg Ratliff from the Gates Foundation, Deborah Schwartz from the MacArthur Foundation, and Christine Looney from the Ford Foundation.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Greg Ratliff with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and I'm here with Deborah Schwartz from the MacArthur Foundation, Christine Looney with the Ford Foundation. And we want to talk to you about impact investing and the history we've had. And this has been a great conference for me because I ran the impact investment portfolio at MacArthur in the 90s and have been working in higher education for the last 10 years. So I'm sort of coming back in. And it's interesting to see a lot of things change. A lot of issues like exits stay the same. Mm-hmm. And I thought we might start off with some reflections from Christine about the current state of the field, where we are. You've just done, I know, a landscape analysis. So maybe tell us what you've learned.
Sure. Well, first of all, it's great to be here. And I'm excited to see so many people in the room. I think Ford started this market scan. But probably before I talk about that, it might be good to give some history and context for our involvement in the market, which started really in the late 60s when we started making PRIs, worked with the IRS to allow private foundations to make them. And since then, we've had almost 50 years of investment experience, which in and of itself has given us a lot of lessons and practical experiences in the field. But I think as importantly, when I think and being on a panel with Deborah especially, who's been such a partner to Ford in all of our work over the years, it's important to kind of reflect on what some of our most important or most meaningful investments have taken to kind of get to the stage they're at today. And if I reflect on markets like the community development finance market in the United States or the microfinance market overseas, Ford and MacArthur and others were early stage investors in these organizations. And it wasn't just the investment capital, though, that made this field grow to where it was today. It was a combination of investments plus grants, a lot of support to things like trade associations and ratings agencies and measurement tools, and just even capacity building for these institutions. And so if you look at the self-helps, for one example, who started small and is now almost $1 billion organization.
$2 billion
organization. Yeah. Mm. You know, I think it's important to kind of look at, to see kind of what it took to get them there. We found ourselves, you know, about a year and a half ago with a new president, Darren Walker, and we were looking at the growth of this space and looking at the role that we had in it. And we'd been investing at that point really to support our own programs. We'd been doing some grants, but once again, to really support our own programmatic initiatives. And we were kind of reflecting on the amazing growth that was taking on in the impact investing market, the number of new investors, and kind of stepped back and said, well, what role should philanthropy be playing in this? And is there a role for Ford within this? And so we engaged Monitor Deloitte to really help us do a scan of the market, to really just kind of level set where we thought the market was at. And I think for those of you who are, you know, practitioners in this space, what we found won't be alarming to you. It was, one thing that came out was that there was a lot of hype in the market, that this was the solution for all solutions and that everyone can make, you know, tons of money and deliver the impact. I think there was a level of huge investor appetite, but maybe a lot more work needs to be done in terms of investor preparedness. On the demand side, we saw just a huge growth in the sophistication of the types of products and organizations and funds that were emerging, but a continued need for more organization to help investors not only find them or them to find investors, for general marketing and communications of those products. And then in the middle, some very nascent and emerging market infrastructure, but that needed to be developed further to help connect those two, and I think Deborah will really speak to that. That was kind of the first stage of almost our level setting of the market, and the second was really a dive into, well, you know, Ford could enter this, but in and of itself, we could do little, so what would it look like if we took a collaborative approach to this work? And so I'd say the next phase of this for us has really been speaking with so many of you to see where there are opportunities for collaboration and to develop kind of partners for us as we kind of start this initiative.
Yeah. No, that's great. Deborah, do you have anything further to add in terms of the state of the field?
Thanks. And I would just build off what Christine says, that I think Ford and MacArthur and Packard and many others, have been at this for a long time. But I think that was for a set of challenges and enterprises that don't look like the full scope of the social sector today. You know, we have a much wider spectrum of everything from pure nonprofits that are looking to build what the Heron Foundation calls philanthropic equity, to hybrid models, and we've worked a lot in the affordable housing space with joint ventures and LLCs. There's all of those kinds of things, to public-private partnerships, special purpose vehicles. So what's really wonderful, right, is there's this incredible spectrum in the social sector, and now there's also this incredible spectrum of investors. Right, everything from the mainstream investors we just heard from, the BlackRocks and Bain and others, Morgan Stanley, Goldman, and it's a long list. A whole emerging class of specialty advisors and also mainstream advisors who are building mission into their practice, high net worth individuals, and then retail investors. And you heard from Calvert, which has been in that retail end of the spectrum, as well as an incredible array of foundations. And the Mission Investors Exchange, with which Christine and I were part of when it first began 12 some odd years ago, has 250 foundations. The Global Impact Investors Network, Global Confluence Philanthropy, US SIF. So there is an incredible, wonderful, vibrant community. But to Christine's point, the next challenge is really how do we as foundations that have significant capital to put to work, and we have $300 million dedicated 100% to impact. We also have a 30-year track record, so not quite as long, but we've deployed about $500 million, and we've learned a lot, as Christine said. And so I think the next generation of our work is how to bring those assets, our risk tolerance, our capacity to do dogged problem solving, and how to take all of that, as well as the kind of ingenuity that it's taken to really build up individual sectors and individual enterprises, and how do we help build a marketplace that really, in a fluid and meaningful way, connects the flow of capital, making it easier for those who are trying to raise the capital to get it on the terms that really work, capital that's suitable, not just capital, but capital that's suitable. How do we make it easier and more suitable for investors of all kinds to play together? And I think I'll just leave it with saying, you know, the G8 Task Force report last year, the Global Task Force, talked about this next generation being about risk, return, and impact. I would say that the work that our foundations and others have done for the last 30 to 50 years has been all about creatively applying tools of various kinds to meld risk, return, and impact. Our next generation of work needs to really be about ease, suitability, liquidity, because we've got to get to a much more efficient ecosystem so entrepreneurs don't end up struggling so hard and so long to cobble together the resources they need for the invention and innovation work, for the growth and scale, and for their long-term success. It's just too hard and too slow.
Yeah. No, that's really great. So you guys talk a lot about the proliferation of actors and players in the space, the kinds of transactions that are being done. I mean, it's a really dynamic time. And I'm curious, you mentioned risk. What are the challenges in that new space? You've got all these new people coming in. They're trying to figure out how to work together. What are the issues you're most concerned about as you move forward?
Maybe I'll start. So I think for me, there are a couple. I think one is with new entrants and new energy, people may be starting to almost recreate the wheel when others have been kind of working on things for quite a long time, and it's out there, but we just haven't done a good enough job marketing some of this, and so
people are sharing the models.
It.
Yeah.
The second, it's come up quite a bit, but is this kind of fear of greenwashing, that we have new investors coming in who are almost selling their products with impact as a selling point, but maybe it's not as front and center to what they actually really want to do, and so is this market in jeopardy of that? And maybe the third is maybe around just overall complexity. It's complexity of language and the perpetuation of that, how many different ways we're kind of all describing what we're doing. I think it makes it pretty confusing for new entrants coming in the space. And then the second is this complexity of product development. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've worked on many transactions together where we're, you know, one of up to 20 investors, all with very boutique interests in transactions, and it's costly and time-consuming, and I'm not even sure at the end of the day we're all even extremely satisfied with where we got. So we need to really simplify not only the language but the products we're putting out there to make it easier for capital to flow more effectively.
Yeah, I mean, when we think about the global kind of risks within the marketplace, I agree. I think there's a very healthy discussion at this venue and others about this issue of quote unquote impact or good washing. I would put it a little differently. I think that we have to be honest that not all kinds of capital are going to be right for certain kinds of problems, and that when you're looking at certain kinds of enterprises, really honing in on sort of deep, challenging social, environmental issues, enterprises that may be very untested, very innovative, unusual markets, The truth is we need to be very actively making the capital work for them. And that's what I would call sort of deep impact. You know, it's not just enough to have money and motivation. You actually have to be prepared to look at how to blend the public, the private, the philanthropic capital and make the solution work. Those kinds of investments, I've often said, are not just made, they're not just lying around. You know, they're made, not found.
Right.
The problem I see is that as large flows of capital come into the space, if we don't build some products, to Christine's point, that make the connection, I think it's unreasonable to expect that the large deployment of capital is going to be able to do that artisanal finance, right? And so I think we'll get a lot of shallow impact, which will be okay. It'll be good. It'll be better than it is today. But it may leave out the ability to really continue scaling things that are incredibly valuable to solving some of the biggest problems in our world. And so
Right. Our
challenge is how to go to deep impact and not just shallow impact. And I think that's one. The other is sort of the shadow of subprime, and also some things that happened in the microcredit world. I think when investors' expectations are inflated or hyped, and you get a lot of money rushing in, you get very smart people who say, there's money for me to make if I wrap myself in the impact mantle. And so there is a job for foundations, I think, but for all of us to be good stewards of mission. And that's never going to be cut and dried.
Right. No, those are great. Great comments. Thank you, guys. So let's get to the good stuff. So, you know, you mentioned, Deborah, your $300 million compared to the $75 trillion of the mainstream investors, right? And so increasingly foundations are a smaller part of the capital in the impact investing space. So I'd love to hear you talk a little bit about how you see your role shifting and how it needs to shift, and then maybe transition into, based on your sense of the landscape, what are the specific things you're planning to do going forward? What kinds of projects? How are you going to position yourself? How are you going to collaborate?
Well, again, I want to echo what Christine said. I think that, you know, we're just like Ford, very mindful, and we started about 2 years ago looking at this exact question around the same time that Christine and Darren and Frank and Zav, other colleagues at Ford, were looking at this, because we're mindful of this incredible opportunity, right? More capital than ever, wanting to find ways to be meaningful. And, you know, we've learned how to knit together the deals that unlock impact on a transaction-by-transaction-by-transaction basis, and that's powerful, right? I mean, we have 15 years of working on one issue alone, rental housing in the United States, and our $200 million investment in that field, building up a set of enterprises and intermediaries, has unlocked $15 billion in new capital, and hundreds of thousands of lives and homes have been transformed, and that's great. But we can't be the only source of that $200 million. Ford can't be the only source of the capital it's provided to microcredit. So one of the first steps is the collaboration, and Darren Walker convened a set of presidents from foundations that make impact investments earlier this year, and that's an ongoing conversation, and I think that's an important part of the future for all of us, is that the institutions themselves that have the most flexibility, that have the greatest ability to take risk and innovate, that we work together to create a real community of support that fosters innovation and a next generation of marketplace capacity. So a couple of specific examples would be the new products that Jen just announced. So in addition to Raisis, a fund called Age Strong, another one that she announced with President Obama around investment in India, MacArthur was able to provide a modest amount of grant support, but it helped them do the legal and technical work involved in a new structure. Another is Impact US, or Impact Us, excuse me, Liz, and both Ford and MacArthur have provided seed capital to build a new online marketplace. And Liz will be talking, she's somewhere in the room, I think, at 12:15 today, she'll be talking about that. Another, to the point that Christine made, is documenting what we already know about creative solutions. And Bruce Campbell will be talking about the Innovative Term Sheet Project, which Ford and Heron and Piton and Sorensen and Blue Haven have all funded. Because we can provide a library, a playbook, and people, both entrepreneurs and investors, will not be stuck having to figure this all out from scratch. So those are just some examples. Mm-hmm. I have one more, but why don't we shift over to Christine?
Sure. Yeah, so I think to your first point in terms of the role of philanthropy, this was a question that came out in our market scan, and I think resoundingly, whoever we interviewed kind of voiced that there is a big role for philanthropy to play in this growing market. And I think for foundations, it's kind of looking at all the resources we have available to contribute. And they're beyond, I mean, grants are an important piece, the investment capital and our ability to be flexible with that and as catalytic as possible in terms of supporting growth in the market will be really important. There are also things like convening power. There are things like the leadership that these foundation presidents can bring to the conversation, both in terms of really bringing home this notion of impact and being a standard for good practice in the market. So I think there are many, many opportunities in terms of philanthropy's ability to engage. For Ford, going forward, I think for us, we're looking at something that will be almost a three-part strategy that will include a grant component as part of a new impact investing initiative that will be very market-facing. I mean, I think to Deborah's point, we're going to try to support as many things as we can that will be catalytic to the market and better connect the investors and the demand side. We will be engaging quite a bit in terms of supporting public policy. And I think we've had an important win with the recent Treasury guidance. There's a lot of positive momentum around ERISA. But bringing, I think, alongside these movements in public policy, the really necessary communications and education that will really make these policies not just move forward, but actually effective and so that we can implement them and actually have more capital flow to the issues we care about. And the third will be within our own investment fund strategy. And there, I think for Ford, we're really looking at how we can engage in markets and make markets more effective versus looking at particular transactions and individual investments. So the more effective we can be at that in being a real catalyst and being flexible, I think the better and more of a contribution we'll be able to make to the market.
Deborah?
Yes, so echoing Christine, I think we're going to be putting grant dollars to work to help share innovations that exist, new ones that are coming into being, and be a resource in that way to help, again, foster kind of a community of collaboration and product innovation and market building. I think it is important to recognize that matchmaking in this world is important, right? And there's some really exciting platforms emerging. But matchmaking itself, the matching, is not going to be sufficient, that if we really want to connect the supply and the demand sides of this marketplace, we actually need to do true market making, and that means putting our capital at risk and finding others who are willing to put capital at risk in a completely different way. So I'll give you an example of a product innovation, because I think we are not going to get to a liquid, suitable set of products that really allow large flows of capital to come into the deep end of the pool if we don't actually make that happen. So, for example, this summer we completed a transaction where the foundation, instead of just providing risk mitigation, you know, we've done that for many, many years, where we will provide just enough first loss or guarantee protection, you know, to help an investor say, okay, it's a little bit unusual, or I'm a little bit uncomfortable, but now I'm okay, or to basically get the risk-return equation to work. In this transaction, we did something called a liquidity facility, and for those of you who don't come out of investment banking, that is not, a liquidity facility is not a glass of wine, it is not a room in your house, or the kitchen sink. A liquidity facility is a way of standing behind an investment and saying, when you, investor, are ready to exit, we, over here, the market maker, will buy you out. And we will buy you out and take the risk that nobody will ever want that security. And then, hopefully, what we will actually do is be able to then be the bridge to the next investor. And the reason we did this, it was a large social enterprise that had hit what we all know as the Valley of Death. We had helped launch it together with Ford 2 years before. It had scaled up to a certain point, but the equity that it had wasn't sufficient to get to the next level of growth. And it needed to get to that next level to start to really tap in to more mainstream investors. So here's this classic gap. And what we were able to do was to bring two financial institutions to the table who really didn't want to do equity. That was not their thing. And they really didn't like the idea that this was an investment that had a 10-year horizon and actually no real mechanism for exit. This was not a fund, and the equity does not have a life on it. It's indefinite life. So we provided a 25% promise that a quarter of that equity would be something we would be willing at MacArthur to buy at a later date. And it worked. So that's just an example of what we mean by trying to actually inject liquidity to this next stage of the market. And we have other projects underway, and we really look forward to conversations because we think there are ways to engineer new models.
So I'm wondering if you guys, to the degree you're willing to name names, could say a little more about the kinds of financial institutions and partners you think you need to sort of realize this vision. Because listening to you, I'm going to play a little devil's advocate, I hear you meeting with each other, foundations and foundations talking. And to pull this off, that can't be the case. Yeah. And so how do you include more mainstream financial actors in the dialogue and the structuring and design?
Well, I'll just tell you, I mean, we have five or six big projects underway. We're talking to investment banks, to family offices, to RIAs, you know, and that's one of the things that's so exciting for us is that the real explosion of interest in impact investing means that we have a much wider array of potential partners. But at the end of the day, there are a set of players, and big foundations are among them, who bring important kinds of resources into the mix. So we are, I think, necessary but not going to be sufficient. And to use Christine's word, we need to catalyze this community of market building. It'll not be any one of us cannot do this. We need talent and expertise, traditional capital markets, tools and expertise. All of that's going to be required.
Yeah, I mean, I would completely agree. I think just partnering with foundations would have been the easier play. But as you said, we're such a small percentage of this market. And so, like Deborah, I mean, we're in our conversations, they've expanded much, you know, well beyond philanthropy. We've really been attempting to be strategic in terms of where are the big pots of capital and what will it really take over time to unlock that. And so having conversations with like CIO investor roundtables and people like that who
and donor advised funds,
and,
donor advised funds
and government, importantly, as a huge kind of catalyst beyond philanthropy in this market. And so I think it's going to take many different types of institutions to kind of make this as effective as we'd like it to be. So we're open to those partnerships.
That's great. Well, we are out of time, so we'll have to come back next year to hear how it all goes.
Exactly.
But please join me in thanking our panelists.
All right. So we've been hearing these pieces kind of individually. We've heard from the foundations. We've heard from these major financial institutions. But to make any of these deals happen, if any of you have tried to do it, takes a whole set of stakeholders coming together. And I think sometimes it's helpful to understand a particular case study to see the way that these various players all come together, the way each of you, in whatever role you have, can play a role in this. So I'm excited to bring to the stage Gabriella Parcella, from CEO and President of Mellon Capital, who's going to talk about the role that they had in helping a family foundation work through some ways that they wanted to address climate change, use their investment dollars to do that, and the way that Mellon Capital was able to support that. Welcome to the stage, Gabriella Parcella.
Hello, everybody. It's great to be here. Great to see so many faces and a couple of familiar ones out here. So I'm going to share a story with you guys today. And it's a story about investing in a way to help make social change. And to start off, I wanted to share. So Mellon Capital is an institutional investment management firm, and that means that we work with foundations, endowments, and pension plans, and we've done that in a very traditional way over the last 30 years. But recently, one of our clients came to us and gave us a really difficult question. And the question was, how can we take our investment dollars that are part of the portfolio and put them to work in a way that will help support our mission? And they really wanted to focus on environmental objectives. And you guys might say, if you don't work with many institutional investors, what's the big deal? Why does it take so long? Why don't those institutions just start putting their dollars to work? And it's this balance of figuring out how do we meet that fiduciary duty and still invest in a way to support environmental objectives. And having been a lawyer, I'm kind of a recovering lawyer turned CEO, I can tell you that this fiduciary duty is real, and it's difficult. It's a constraint right now that we're trying to break through. And that is because if you look at the words and the rules right now, they're written in a way that we have to focus on the exclusive financial benefit to the beneficiaries, and that is something that we can kind of get tripped up on. Now, the good news is we're seeing more and more that there's acceptance that environmental factors are, in fact, risk factors that need to be considered as we're putting portfolios together, and that's really promising. So my story begins 2 years ago, and that's when the McKnight Foundation came to us and said, all right, Mellon Capital, you've been our manager for close to 30 years now, and you manage our portfolio that helps fund our foundation. And we'd like to figure out how to get those investment dollars under the control of our investment committee to work in furtherance of our mission. And if you don't know the McKnight Foundation, they're a $2 billion foundation based out of Minneapolis, and their mission is to improve the quality of life for current and future generations. And they've been working on investing toward that mission through their grant program, but they hadn't figured out a way to get their investment portfolio to also support the mission. So they came to us and said, can you help us here? And we did. And actually, it took about a year, if you can believe that. And it wasn't just working with the McKnight Foundation, but they also had two consultants that they're working with, Mercer and Imprint Capital. So the four of us got together and started a very heated and healthy debate about how best to do this. And as you can imagine, anytime you get four organizations together, we all are very passionate about investing and about ways to make an impact. So it did take us a little bit over 10 months to come up with a strategy that we all felt comfortable with. And this process of collaboration and partnership that we went through was actually quite unique, and so much so that Oxford University actually wrote a case study about our project and made that part of their impact investing program that they presented at the said business school. So we're very excited about that. So in the end, we decided that of all the environmental objectives that we could focus on, we would focus on carbon. And I wanted to share a bit about why. Although given this crowd, you guys probably know a lot of these facts. I'll just share it with you briefly. So this is what we know about the numbers. We know that an average passenger vehicle emits 4.75 metric tons of carbon dioxide. We also know that it will take 122 tree seedlings 10 years to be able to sequester that carbon. And even beyond that, we know that an average American household actually emits 10 times more carbon than a passenger vehicle. So clearly, there's a lot of emissions that are happening. And when we looked at the concentration of carbon dioxide globally, you see this rather frightening steep escalation. And this really inspired us to focus on carbon as an area where there's urgency to act, and it's really the time to act is now. So with that as our kind of goal, we looked at a lot of different alternatives, and we're often asked, why not just divest? Just don't invest in any companies, any fossil fuel companies, or any companies related to fossil fuel. And you've heard in the press quite a bit across college campuses, there's been big cries for just full divestment from endowments. After looking at this carefully, we decided that this was not the right approach for us for two reasons. The first is that full divestment was going to create risk in the portfolio, risk of potentially not getting the returns that were needed and also increasing volatility. But second, and actually as important, if not more importantly, if you fully divest, you lose the opportunity to engage with those issuers. And we feel like it's very important to help drive change from within the companies. And when we go in and we engage with the companies, we're really asking for two things. We're asking for greater disclosure, because if you've looked into this, you'll see that not all companies disclose, and even those that do disclose, disclosure could be improved. And then secondly, we're asking for a clear plan for how they will reduce emissions in the future or will invest in other renewable energy sources. So we think that's the best, most comprehensive approach. So the solution we came up with was the carbon efficiency strategy. And what this is, it's a broad-based equity strategy where we look at individual issuers and then we decide whether those issuers are ones that should be rewarded, should be penalized, and they could be penalized down to a zero holding. And we also look to engage, as I just mentioned earlier. And what was really important in creating this was something that was clearly measurable and objective. And so the standards that we put out is, you know, first on the reduction of carbon, the portfolio has to reduce the carbon emissions by 50% or greater. Second, from a fiduciary perspective, we want to make sure that we have enough risk management in the portfolio that we won't deviate from the stated benchmark by any more than 50 basis points. And then third, again, we engage with the companies that we invest in. So that was the three-prong approach that we put together to create the strategy for McKnight. Now, Mellon Capital is owned by the Bank of New York Mellon, and the Bank of New York Mellon has really started to up their engagement with social finance. And you might have seen some white papers they wrote recently about the five characteristics, the five things that are needed if you want to bring social finance to scale. And the story I just shared with you about the McKnight Foundation touches on all five of these characteristics that are needed. It's accessibility. There's accessibility for institutional investors to put their dollars to work in favor of reducing carbon. It's measurable because we set out these two targets of reducing emissions by 50% and keeping the tracking error to 50 basis points. It's a transparent strategy that invests in publicly available securities, publicly traded securities. We're looking for a systemic change through reduction of carbon. And then lastly, collaboration, which I shared. It was these four organizations coming together to develop a strategy together. So in conclusion, what we're looking to see and what we're very excited about is that, you know, finally we're seeing ESG factors being taken seriously as risk factors that can be included in a portfolio. And we're having a lot of really interesting dialogue now with other institutional investors, foundations, endowments, government plans, and pension funds. And we're having those conversations not just in the U.S., but across the globe. So there's a real interest globally to try to make a difference. And we're hoping that Mellon Capital will be able to play its part in working with organizations to put their investment dollars to work in a way that can make an impact and can help their greater mission. And I guess my ask for all of you here today is that perhaps after hearing this story, you can think about how you can put your own personal investment dollars to work. Because it really takes all of us, if we all put our own investment dollars to work, that's really the way that in the end we'll be able to solve some of the world's toughest problems. Thank you.
All right, so when you work in this field, you meet a lot of amazing people. And some of them are amazing because of the work they're doing. Some are amazing because they're so willing to spend their time with you, to exchange ideas with you. I hope you all meet those people while you're at SOCAP. I'm excited to bring to the stage two people who I absolutely cherish every minute I get to spend with them. I've learned more from Fran Siegel over the last 5 years than just about anybody else. And Ariane, I've met more recently, but is someone who's always thoughtful, always wants to hear a good question, And the benefit of having them both up here is not because they're wonderful people, but also because Ariane is one of those people who has found that magical space where financial return and impact are not compromised. He's running a very successful fund called Core Innovation Capital, and I'm excited for you to hear from them, the way that works, the way Ariane thinks about this work, the impact that he's having, and all of the other topics that they're going to fit into the next few minutes. So please welcome Fran and Ariane.
Can you hear me? I'm Fran Siegel. I am Chief Investment Officer of Impact Assets, which is a nonprofit financial services firm focused on increasing the flow of capital to impact investing. And I am delighted to be in dialogue with Ariane Schutte, who is a founder and managing director of Core Innovation Capital. Just, we wanted to kind of contextualize our discussion for a moment. You've heard this morning a fair amount about mainstreaming and about incumbents entering the field, institutions putting capital to work. And Ariane and I are both really passionate about democratizing, about making financial services, making impact investing available to all, to the retail investor. And so we hope that we can offer a slight point of contrast to some of the other speakers this morning. The other thing is, we talked a lot about the supply side of capital, so drawing more capital into the space, whereas Ariane's work and his partner, Kathleen, his business partner, Kathleen, put money to work. And so we'll be talking about impact entrepreneurs, not just the supply of capital, but also the demand for capital. So a first kind of opening salvo is the Core Innovation invests in companies that serve the domestic unbanked and underbanked. So I'm wondering if you could talk about what that market is and quantify it if you can, and talk about why the sector is growing.
Sure. So thanks, Fran, and it's great to be here. I kind of came to this after reading a book about a guy named Mohammed Yunus, and he was new to me, and microfinance was new to me. I'd spent a decade building educational software in a bunch of venture-backed companies, and I was just really genuinely blown away with what they'd done. And I'm an immigrant here myself, and so I didn't want to go to Bangladesh or India, and I was really interested and kind of inspired when Al Gore was sent packing when he went to visit India and talked about global warming, and they said, you come from the biggest polluter, go back home and fix your own backyard. And so I've been really inspired to do what we can from our side to fix our own backyard. So I went looking for who's doing this kind of stuff in the United States, and I found myself in the south side of Chicago visiting with the founders of ShoreBank. For some of those who know about ShoreBank, they've, from their little corner of things, done an incredible amount to really advance community development and financial inclusion, not just in Chicago or in the United States, but really globally. And so, while on one hand I was really deeply inspired by what they'd built, I also looked at what that community had done in terms of scale. And after about 40 or 50 years, the community development movement, while it has done remarkable things in local neighborhoods, if you add it all up and look at it from a United States perspective, is serving about 0.5% of the population. And so it hasn't scaled particularly well. And so one aha was, gosh, there's incredible work, important and powerful work going on, but it hasn't scaled at all. And so when you look at the United States, right, the income divide is growing, and that represents a dire policy problem. Many tens of millions of customers underutilize traditional banks and overutilize alternatives. Those alternatives are extremely expensive. It's expensive to be poor, as it sadly turns out. So this is also a dire need. But there's also a flip side to it, and that is not just a need, it also is an incredible opportunity. And so as we started looking at how do we reframe this as an opportunity, right, you start looking at it from a revenue perspective. And so the need that we have around financial security for low-income people in the United States and financial mobility for low-income people in the United States actually represents about $100 billion on annual revenue that low-income people spend on very basic financial products, all products that probably almost everyone in this room gets for almost free. And so no matter how empathetic we all may be, we basically live in a bubble, and it is hard to imagine the incredible expense that is incurred by an incredible number of people who live all around us. And so looking at it through a market lens was really the aha that led to the creation of CORE and to the thesis of investing in financial services companies that could serve low-income people at scale to the tunes of tens of millions as opposed to hundreds or thousands or maybe tens of thousands, and do so in a way that is profitable and uplifting for them economically.
Mm-hmm. I spoke yesterday in a session with Kathy Clark about how focused I am on the microfinance movement and global sustainable agriculture lending in emerging markets. And you touched on this a little bit, but how those markets in some ways from a lending perspective are ahead of the United States, and what can we learn from microfinance and global sustainable agriculture, which really look at the rural poor and the urban poor as strong credit risks, and what can we do to help build the credit rating of folks at the bottom of the pyramid. And just wondering if you can kind of elaborate on that. You have roots in both microfinance and community banking, but it just occurs to me in the wake of the financial crisis and subprime lending that the low to moderate income folks have kind of gotten a bad rap, in some ways worse than ever before. And so can you talk a little bit about some of those market factors?
Yeah, so clearly there's a lot to learn from what's happening around the world. And in many very important and annoying ways, the United States is antiquated and behind from its financial services offerings. However, I've been scouring for a decade now to find ways to translate what's happening abroad and apply that here. It's been very hard to do that in many cases literally, because the financial services infrastructure in the United States is so different. There are other places in the world where they are similar, like South Africa or Brazil are more similar than or the UK or the EU than many other places. But it's hard to replicate literally. And so where there is tremendous power and lessons from abroad to be applied here is more metaphorically speaking. And so, for example, this notion of a social collateral is something that the United States barely utilizes. So there's about 70 million Americans who don't have a FICO score. And that doesn't mean that they are subprime or irresponsible. It just means that there isn't the data in TransUnion, Equifax, and Experian that create a FICO score. And so they're invisible. And so it's a continuous challenge for the United States financial services system to underwrite this customer accurately, so they're not risk-adjusted. They're basically treating all of these thin-file or no-file customers as subprime customers at their detriment. And so the microfinance world, for example, has figured out very powerfully how you use your community and your friends and your loved ones and the notion of shame, for example, to decrease defaults. That is hardly utilized in the United States and is a very powerful idea. And one of our portfolio companies is actually trying to do that in a very modern way. So we invested in a company called Vouch. And Vouch is trying to be an alternative to a payday loan. Payday loan famously costs 3-digit APRs. It's easy and to get riled up about that at a cocktail party. But Vouch is trying to address the same customer at 1/10 the price of a payday loan, largely by helping people leverage their social collateral. So helping the lender, Vouch, basically determine the the resilience of someone's character. And character is really hard to define. And so they basically allow you to engage your social community to vouch for you, to sponsor you. You can either say, Fran, I think you're responsible, and be a kind of a soft vouch. Or I could, if you're trying to borrow $5,000, I could say, I'll back you for $100. And you could get 10 people to back you for $100. It's kind of like a cosign. And that's a very modern online translation of a very old idea, right, that's existed in microfinance for a long time and in, you know, more old-fashioned forms of borrowing for millennia before that. Mm-hmm. So as an example of how we're kind of metaphorically importing some ideas from abroad.
So I think of the kind of investing you do at Core as kind of fintech for good, for fintech for impact. There's been a lot of discussion around fintech. It's quote-unquote super hot right now. And how do you see yourself fitting within the broader trend of fintech in serving this very particular constituency?
Yeah, so we're unique in the United States in that we're a fintech investor that knows this sector well, but is decidedly interested in investing in companies that are economically empowering for low-income people. So we have an angle on fintech. We play very nicely, I think, with the broader ecosystem. And by and large, we co-invest with mainstream investors. We'd love to co-invest with more impact investors, but I actually have none as co-investors, but we do have Andreessen Horowitz or Greylock or Google or Venrock or Charles River and many others as co-investors who co-invest with us for a variety of reasons. They may not call it impact, maybe they call it reputation risk management, or maybe they it just gels with one of the partners, or maybe they see it as effectively increasing the enterprise value. Ultimately, if our thesis is right, we're able to align creating high impact and great returns by investing in companies that are going to create long-term value on lots and lots of customers. And that ultimately translates to higher enterprise value. And it plays out in financial services that if you look at companies that are more predatory-like companies that are publicly traded, you actually see that their enterprise value is relatively little on an EBITDA or revenue basis versus companies that provide much longer-term value. And so that's how we're trying to marry these two ideas so that they're actually synergistic to each other as opposed to in conflict.
Mm-hmm. So let's move a little bit now, bridging to financial returns. You probably know Aileen Lee from Cowboy Ventures, who famously coined the term unicorn, which is privately held companies that have valuations of at least $1 billion, and the list is growing of those. And so I'm trying to coin the phrase an impact unicorn. And an impact unicorn is, and I think you invest in impact unicorns, where you can seek to achieve market rates of financial return as well as very, very strong impact, and that the financial returns are released because of and not in spite of the impact. But the true story of impact investing is that it's a spectrum from return of principal to concessionary term to market rate and even premium rates of return. You have spoken specifically about this dichotomy of missionary to mercenary. And I was wondering if you could expand on that dichotomy and say where you think Core fits on that spectrum.
Sure. Well, and I think of it as a spectrum and not a dichotomy. And it's kind of it's meant as a characterization, which is meant to both insult kind of people at either end of the spectrum as a stimulus to get them to think differently. And so, right, I kind of see the spectrum as there are missionaries on one hand, and basically the missionaries are, will give lip service to the business part of it. They know they need to talk that language, but at the end of the day, they're really mission-driven. Nothing wrong with it. Great, very courageous group of people. And there's mercenaries, which I also don't see as particularly wrong, and that's frankly most of society. And, like, you know, these are not evil people, and you know, the good or the impact may be, you know, an afterthought or kind of, you know, the community section on their website or something like that. Nothing wrong with that. There's incredible philanthropic dollars and efforts and well-intended people who are on either end of the spectrum. But you know what I mean? And so from our perspective, as we look at entrepreneurs, the lion's share are in the mercenary category. A very small number of them are in the missionary category, and we've found, sadly, that the missionaries, by and large, are not company builders. It's difficult for them to raise the kind of capital they need to build the kind of scale that we think is important, even though we are agreed with their intentions. And the mercenaries basically don't care enough to build in oversampling of value to low-income consumers into their business models and to go through the heartache and the harder work to make business models that work or to create technology that drives real efficiencies, like an order of magnitude type of efficiency, where you're 10 times better than what was there before. And so we look for what we call the visionaries, who are neither missionary nor mercenary, but they are driven by the desire to really make deep impact, as Deborah referred to. I like that framing. But they are schooled and effective in the business of business. And often they end up being what we call kind of accidental social entrepreneurs. Mm. Many of them don't know what this is or who we are or what is this, you know, SOCAP and the SOCAPs of the world, but they care deeply. And so almost all of our entrepreneurs are accidental social entrepreneurs, and I think we should all look beyond our, right, the converted, to see who are the people who can really take us to the next level, and many times they will not be right here amongst us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so moving from financial returns to impact returns, at Impact Assets, we largely invest in fund managers, and so we have a database of, you know, 500, 600 firms that we follow, and we tend to invest in just a handful a year, in the same way that you look at hundreds of deals and maybe only invest in a handful as well. Mm-hmm. And we talk a lot in the space about aligning impact with financial incentives. But the truth of the matter is, meaning that is the fund manager's financial incentives aligned with the releasing of impact? And I will say that I have seen like very few of these in the wild. We all see it, you know, it's a good idea, but you know, it's very rare. And Core Innovation Capital is one of the few fund managers that do this kind of alignment, and I'm wondering if you can speak about that.
Sure. So we're looking to make market rate returns, which in the venture space is actually very difficult, because venture capital, for those of you who don't know, is actually a really crappy asset class. There's a power curve in venture, so almost all venture capitalists underperform S&P 500, let alone get anything close to what people think of as venture returns. And so the notion of concessionary within venture capital, I think, is a bit of a misnomer, because it is discounting a already, you know, discounted median performance. So for us, the challenge was, okay, how do we combine these two? And how do we stay true to being high impact and delivering deep impact? And so we clearly have our toes to the fire in terms of creating great financial returns, and our LPs bug me about this every day or whenever they get a chance, that we should be, you know, like pushing that harder. We've tried to build into our inner fiber, into our general partnership agreement and our limited partnership agreement, also holding our toes to the fire to create great and scalable social impact. And it's something that is unique, and it shouldn't be. And it's something that I would love to see more in our industry, that we don't just rely on our good intentions. And everyone here is incredibly well-intentioned. But good intentions are the road to, I forgot, but you know, setting up an accountability mechanism is very important to help us execute highly against our good intentions. And so we've built this system by which we basically tie our compensation to our, not just our financial return, but our impact. And so when we underwrite a company, we look for a variety of impact metrics. How many low moderate income are they serving? Can they get to scale? Can they reach millions? Are they saving them something like an order of magnitude over the best alternative? And can they help the customer in the long term build assets, build credit, and find a pathway to the financial mainstream? And then every year, we create an objective report with data reported from our portfolio companies. We have a three-person impact audit committee that is independent from us, that scores us from 1 to 100, and that score equals 100% of our bonus and 10% of our carry. And it's broken down to a number of parts. And that practice, in very practical ways, has really helped us improve the way we execute against that. And so, you know, if we get a score of 8 or 7 or something like that in part of our impact metric, that is embarrassing, right? Like, that is not why we're doing this. We're doing this to be in the top 1%, mm-hmm. the top 5%. And so we've made changes. And, you know, again, like, I don't need to be reminded why I'm doing this, but, like, having that mechanism is incredibly powerful, and it's mm-hmm. something that I would really like to see and encourage more people who are investing in funds or people who are managing funds to self-impose, right? To create a mechanism to follow Peter Drucker's kind of famous mantra of what's measured gets managed, to create excellence, not just in great financial returns, but social returns as mm-hmm. well.
Well, thank you. Behold, ladies and gentlemen, an impact unicorn.
Thank you.
All right, so we've got our last speaker coming up, and this is really a treat. So this is about the feet on the ground. This is about the people who are actually doing work and having tremendous impact. We're about to welcome Prince Emmanuel de Merode from Virunga National Park. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Prince Emmanuel. After training as an anthropologist, Dr. Emmanuel de Merode worked for 20 years in support of Congo's national parks. He spent most of those years in the field supporting Congolese park rangers through the 12-year civil war that claimed the lives of over 5 million civilians and 140 of the rangers with whom he worked. In 2007, after witnessing the slaughter of 9 mountain gorillas by armed militias and investigating the root causes of environmental destruction in eastern Congo, he decided to focus his efforts on overcoming the illegal trafficking of natural resources in Virunga National Park. As a result of these efforts, he was appointed as chief warden of Virunga National Park by the Congolese government in 2008. To overcome the various challenges in the post-conflict region, he helped to develop the Virunga Alliance, a Congolese initiative to create an alternative clean development strategy capable of eradicating poverty and bringing stability and peace to eastern Congo based on the sustainable use of water resources for energy and fisheries, together with agriculture and tourism. It's a real treat. Please welcome Prince Emmanuel de Merode.
Thank you. Yeah, okay, thanks. Good morning. It's an incredible privilege. I'm extremely grateful to be here. I think I, perhaps more than most, need to explain who I am. I'm a bit of an outlier with respect to a lot of the discussions that are going on today. But actually, I'd like, over the next few minutes, just explain how important the work that people like yourselves are doing to the future of a region that desperately needs change. And really, the way I would like to do that is through the extraordinary team that I work with. In that, to explain who I am, I'm essentially what you would define as a middle-ranking civil servant in the Congolese public service. I work for the government of the Democratic Republic of Congo as a national park warden, as the director of a national park that's called Virunga National Park. It's located in the east of the country in a region that has been affected by what is now recognized as the most tragic episode in human history in terms of human suffering since the Second World War, a war that's claimed the lives of over 6 million Congolese people, 6 million people who should not have died in that way. And every single one of those wars has started either in or immediately around this national park that we've been trying to manage now for over 20 years. And it's this extraordinary team that I work with whose story it is I tell. But for me, at the beginning, growing up in East Africa, growing up in Kenya, I had this very different image. I had this image of this landscape in the center of Africa with these incredible mountains, some of the highest mountains on the African continent, with glaciers on top, and that stretched down through tropical rainforests across these amazing savannas with some of the greatest abundance of large mammals, of elephants, hippos, and buffaloes, and then through to these extraordinary volcanoes, these permanently erupting volcanoes that give you a glimpse of the very center of the Earth. And between these extremes, some of the greatest diversity of wildlife on Earth, what essentially made it, what essentially makes it probably the greatest national park on Earth. And of course, that one species that drew me to Virunga 23 years ago, which is the mountain gorilla, this incredibly vulnerable species that's right on the edge of extinction. But when I arrived, I bought a motorbike in Kampala and drove across East Africa and then across the border, across the great East African Rift Valley, and then down into this amazing landscape. What brought me there were the mountain gorillas and this amazing national park. But what really kept me there was this team of Congolese rangers. And very quickly, what I realized as I became, over the years, a part of that team, was just the incredible sacrifice that they had gone through. Over 140 of them had died protecting this park, and yet for months and sometimes years on end, they hadn't received their salaries, they hadn't received any support from the outside world, and yet they were continuing this struggle because it was the work that they had always done, that their parents had done, and their grandparents had done. This is the oldest national park in Africa. It's the first, it's where conservation was born in Africa, and this tradition was continuing in spite of the incredible difficulties. And it was met with incredible success. The mountain gorillas were increasing. They doubled over the last 20 years until this terrible day in 2007 when we heard gunshots up in the forest came across the beginning of what was seemingly the end of this species, the mountain gorillas. They were being exterminated by militias that were moving into the forest and killing the gorillas. And that really was the event that precipitated a series of decisions that ended up with a situation where I was asked by the government to take on this incredible privilege, which was to lead Virunga's rangers as their director. And so we continued from there. But what I didn't realize was that my work was not going to be about protecting mountain gorillas or wildlife or managing a national park. It was about managing a deeply, deeply troubled political situation. And within weeks of when I was appointed, we discovered that an army was being created, a rebel army, and very soon that erupted into the third of the great wars of Eastern Congo, these wars that killed literally millions of people. And of course, this was the view just outside my tent when I woke up in the morning. It was a war that came right up to the park headquarters. And within days, our staff were forced out on this terrible march towards the city of Goma and into these internally displaced camps. Suddenly, I found myself from being a park director to being somebody who had to manage a refugee camp for the rangers and their families. And suddenly we had to readapt ourselves to a situation of crisis. This continued, but I was surrounded by these very extraordinary people, and it's them really who led me forward, helped me with these ideas, And the first was the decision never to leave the park. And so we spoke to people, we spoke to the rebel leaders, we spoke to the government, and out of that came this agreement that the park would continue its work, whatever the political situation. And we were able to continue the work. But what really struck us, what was a real problem, was this struggle with respect to this national park. And there was this one photo, this terrible photo that was taken by a good friend of mine of this woman at the feet of one of our rangers. And it really captured for me the struggle that we were up against. So it's not a simple, matter. This woman was trying to get into the park to obtain charcoal. And of course, the victim here is the woman, but it's not that simple. The woman is a victim of the armed militias who are trying to extract the resources. It's like a protection racket. And you've got this economic situation around the park where you have what is essentially what was once a colonial economy based entirely on the extractive industries that's gradually evolved into a conflict economy. And it's based around the extraction of charcoal in the forest, the destruction of the forest for charcoal, this destruction of the water resources for illegal fishing, and then more recently, this international corporation that came into the park for illegal oil. And this economy was essentially based on coercion and patronage and was breeding these armed groups. And what we found was this situation where we had 12 armed militias that were drawn to the park around these resources, fish on the lake, illegal fishing on the lake, charcoal in the forests, and then this illegal oil. And the three together were generating about $100 million a year for the armed groups. And we were completely disempowered in our ability to confront this. And you know, one way of explaining this is through my colleagues, Innocent Mbrenoumwe, my deputy, whose brother was killed protecting the mountain guerrillas, Rodrigue, who spearheaded the investigation into the illegal oil. For his efforts, he was illegally detained for 17 days and very, very badly tortured to the extent that we had to get him out of the country. And then Atama, this dear man who I worked with right from the beginning 23 years ago, who moved up through the ranks and became a warden. One day when he was coming back to the park, he was shot in the back by militias and died of his injuries. And so we were losing all these amazing people who were helping us to protect the park. My day came on a warm day in April when I submitted the report on the investigation into the illegal oil to the state prosecutor, this investigation that we've been carrying out for 4 years into the illegal exploration for oil. I believed, as I still do now in my naivety, that there is something about the sanctity of the rule of law, what holds society together. And I submitted this report. As I was coming back, five men were waiting for me in the forest, and they shot me in the chest and in the stomach and left me in the forest. It was two young Congolese farmers who saw this happen. And as I was alone in the forest, they came and picked me up and put me on a motorbike. And for 2 hours managed to get me to this local hospital who performed a miracle that enabled me to go back to my work and to really rethink what we were doing. And really what that came to was this idea that we were just too small, too vulnerable, too weak to really confront these big problems that we were facing. And this idea of the Virunga Alliance, of drawing in other players based on certain values, values to do with upholding the needs and the rights of the most vulnerable and the poorest in society, upholding the needs and the rights of future generations, the whole concept of sustainability, and, of course, of upholding the rule of law, the rules that hold our societies together. But we needed the resources, and those resources really focused around three key things, four if you include fishing. But the first is energy. You know, this idea that you need to recreate a whole new industry, a whole new economy that is based around diversification of the economy, and that's based around this idea that you've got to break the conflict economy that has been there for so long. And really, that is one of the very great challenges. And it's not that it hasn't been tried. You know, the international community, the world has invested $90 billion in Eastern Congo since 2000 in trying to put an end to the war. It's the biggest UN mission in the world, and it's failed. And the reason it's failed is because of the whole demobilization of the armed militias. Where we are, there are between 5,000 and 8,000 of them. It's not that much. It shouldn't be insurmountable. But the demobilization, disarmament, and reintegration process has failed because of the R in that acronym, the reintegration. And that has failed because there are no jobs in Eastern Congo. There's 70, 80% unemployment. And really, the answer lies in the kinds of work that people like yourselves are doing, of creating successful enterprise that can create sustainable livelihoods for those people. And so we looked at those resources that can provide that. And the two untapped resources of Congo, water and the human resources. And you know, what can we do with that to turn this economy around? The others, of course, are agribusiness and tourism, the traditional industry for a national park. And we invested massively in that. It's not perhaps not massively by your standards, but for us it was a lot. You know, we've now reached an investment, you know, committed funds of about $92 million to try and get sustainable energy to these communities. And what we discovered is that in doing that, for every megawatt of electricity that you provide to conflict-affected communities, you can create between 800 and 1,000 jobs. And the research that we did in the early days demonstrated that we could create between 100 and 120 megawatts. That's 80 to 100,000 jobs in the community around the park. And we're well on our way now. We've now got the committed funds for 50 megawatts. We're halfway there. But if you remember the figure, 5 to 8,000 militias, that's 5 to 8% of those jobs that we're in the process of creating. And so really that's the answer. And it lies right at the heart of the kinds of work that you are doing. One example is the soap factory that has invested in Eastern Congo because of the fact that there's electricity and because of the fact that the park is bringing a degree of stability to that region. The soap factory has created 400 jobs. It's a $5 million investment. 400 jobs in a conflict-affected community, but it's also increased the revenue for 10,000 farmers, and it's decreased the price of soap for 5 million Congolese consumers. And so really, that's the answer to conflict. It's a much smaller investment than the $90 billion from the public sector, and it really comes from the kinds of ideas that people like yourself are developing today. So really that's why I came, was just to thank you for these amazing ideas and for this amazing work that you're doing. Thank you very much. Sorry, I used up more than my fair share of time.
I'm glad you used
the extra
time.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you.
I knew you'd be glad you stayed, but we're going to let you go now.
So the next session starts at 11. I want to let you know there is another plenary this evening from 5:30 to 6:30, so please join us back here for that. And next up, we have a session that sort of continues the theme from the morning that'll start at 11 around impact investing sort of at this tipping point and hitting the mainstream if you'd like to stick around. Thank you so much.